Hallelujah. Thank God for this day, a day that God has made. So let us rejoice and let us be glad in it. Let us proclaim that He is worthy of our praise. Come on, who's ready to praise the Lord this morning? Who's ready to bless the Lord? Who's ready to magnify His holy name? Is anybody out there today? Come on, talk to me. Lift your hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Welcome to San Antonio's Catholic Charismatic Community. Here we proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And by the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah.
I will worship. serve you.
We praise you, Lord. We worship you, Lord Jesus. You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our praise. We praise you, Lord, King of kings and Lord of lords. Ora baba basi konde sheke la bandara sate. Ikorobo sodore shande. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord with your praise. Bless the Lord with your thanksgiving. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Praise God, praise God, praise God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, to prepare to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe.
Adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks.
sleeping flower there. Lord Jesus Christ, Lord living God the Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Glory and praise to you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, my Lord, we bring you glory,
Almighty ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our wills to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, Cyrus, whose right hand I grasp, subduing nations before him and making kings run in his service, opening doors before him and leaving the gates unbarred. For the sake of Jacob, my servant of Israel, My chosen one, I have called you by your name, giving you a title, though you knew me not. I am the Lord, and there is no other. There is no God besides me. It is I who arm you, though you know me not, so that toward the rising and the setting of the sun, people may know that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, there is no other. The word of the Lord.
Proclaim his marvelous deeds to all the nations. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians, in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, remembering you in our prayers, unceasingly calling to mind your work of faith and labor of love, and endurance in hope of our Lord Jesus Christ, before our God and Father, knowing, brothers and sisters loved by God, how you were chosen. For our gospel did not come to you in word alone, but also in power, in the Holy Spirit, and with much conviction. The word of the Lord.
According to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
The Pharisees went off and plotted how they might entrap Jesus in speech. They sent their disciples to him with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are truthful, you are a truthful man, and that you teach the word of God in accordance with the truth. And you are not concerned with anyone's opinion, for you do not regard a person's status. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it lawful to pay the census tax to Caesar or not?" Knowing their malice, Jesus said, "Why are you testing me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin that pays the census tax." Then they handed him the Roman coin. He said to them, "Whose image is this, and whose inscription?" They replied, "Caesar's." At that he said to them, "Then repay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Pour out your Spirit. Spirit on him. Oh.
want to write, you work long hours. He built a big house. He had a fancy car. Or something more substantial, right? You want one something more substantial on that tombstone, in that obituary. Something that's lasting, something that you pass on to others. So he said, the big stones are those that you never want to give up. And as they get smaller, what happens in life is some of them get put into the container and some of them don't. Some get put into the container because you got the big ones in. Not because you were making them a high priority and you were just trying to constantly think how am I going to get these little ones in. But you were focused on the big ones from the start. And you said, I'm going to do the best I can for the smaller ones. Or maybe they'll be delayed. It won't be addressed right away. Right? That's when you look at it, that's a really good way to decide it. In the early church, for example, by the way, are those ones that are a little bit smaller, are they not important? No, they're probably pretty important, right? They're probably pretty important. Otherwise, they wouldn't be like reasonably big stones. They're pretty important. It's just right now, it's not the big stone. It's not the big stone that you need to get in there. And that's why we need the wisdom of the Spirit. Show me what the big stones are, the biggest priorities are in my life. And in these days, life in general. Now, what happens to me, very often, I'll give you an example of how it happens. Happened to me last night. I was working on the intercessions and announcements, and I was having problems with something or another. I was wanting to work on them earlier. I started to, but I didn't get finished. And bottom line is, I got doing something else and something else. And then ended up staying up until 2 o'clock in the morning. Now, whatever those something else were, right. I need sleep so I can be available for you today. Not those something else's. But at that moment, they just caught my mind. They caught my attention. And they distracted me. It's called ADD. Anybody ever hear that? Sometimes the church has ADD. Attention deficit disorder. And it is, we lose focus on those most fundamentals. I have to tell you, a lot of times, the way the devil works is with good people, he doesn't directly get them to do evil. He just distracts them from the primary good with other good. So that, what's his goal? So that the primary good doesn't get accomplished. That's his goal. And then he can take it from there. Because if he can just knock down the key people in terms of focus on the primary good, then he can get other people to be scrambling because they're running around anyway. Because life forces them to run around. And then he can get the rest of us to just, whatever. Or into misguided goods and end up choosing evil. And most of the time people don't choose evil directly. They just usually choose evil because there's a perceived good there. So, I really believe that the devil
How's that? Oh my goodness. I knew that was going to come around. Sorry about that. You got to go like this when you can't hear me. You got to make some noise. Raise those hands. Praise God. We're just doing a new testing of another aspect of the live streaming sound. I hope this one is better. By the way, for the live streaming, this is, well, they can see me anyway. It's the handheld mic. So, where was I? Distraction. Oh, yeah, distraction. Praise God. So, the devil was working through the scribes and the Pharisees to distract Jesus. How was he trying to distract them? Well, by getting him to be defensive. You know, well, I'm trying to please these people. I'm trying to please these people because he's dealing with the reality of the Jewish position in society. Trying to maintain the Jewish security in society because, you see, if the Jews oppose the civil leaders, then they're at risk of being, you know, oppressed further. And if they seem to go along with them too much, then they lose the support of the Jewish people. And so they're trying to play him. They're trying to play Jesus. Can you play Jesus? Hallelujah! You can't play him. That is good news, brothers and sisters. Woo! Thank you, Lord. And He cuts to the quick. You heard it. Whose picture's on this? Okay, let's settle this and get on with more important things. I don't want to play your game. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what belongs to God. What belongs to God? What belongs to God?
Everything!
Everything belongs to God. Everything. So he's like silencing them. Brothers and sisters, the beautiful thing about the Word of God is it shuts down the enemy's chatter. We have to shut down his chatter. It's very important. Sometimes we try to spar with the enemy. Just shut it down. How do you do that? Stay steeped in the Word of God. Stay steeped in his Word and find out what the consistent teaching of the church is. Find out what the church consistently teaches in terms of the priorities. One of the things right now is we are being pulled and tugged by many really important priorities. The environment. Immigration. Racial and social disparity. The economy. They're all pretty big issues, right? They're important. They are important issues. Do I have the answer for them exactly? Oh, Jesus Christ. But other details, Lord, that's why I think they're things that need to be worked on. You know, how we respect God's creation, how we respect one another, starting with the fundamental reality of, if I know how God has redeemed me, do you notice when you experience redemption, the grace of God, it's easier to be loving to others? Did you notice that? You notice when the Lord's mercy touches your heart, it's easier just to be loving. It's easier to be merciful. It just is. God, praise God. Because if I had to do it on my own, it wouldn't work. It wouldn't work. So, and then there are some consistent areas that time doesn't change. Seasons don't change. Now, each of those, they're important. Education, very important. They're really important issues. They're not little pebbles. Those are pretty big stones there. But I want to suggest to you what the church has suggested through the bishops of the United States and through holy fathers over the years that are present battle issues that we need to look at. And they are one that I mentioned 2 weeks ago and spoke in length about, the whole reality of respect for life and all its stages, includes euthanasia and the dynamic of how we have a culture of death, as Pope John Paul II, Pope St. John Paul II said. I like to call him Pope St. John Paul the Great, but I can't do that yet. The church hasn't done that. But he talks about culture of death, that we're a culture that is moving in the realm each area is being influenced by this fundamental area of the most vulnerable, the smallest, the most hidden to our eyes, but the most sacred in a certain sense, because they are so the most innocent. You know, they didn't get an opportunity to sin. And then there's three areas in particular. There's respect life in all its stages. There is the sacredness of the institution of marriage and family. Because remember, that what the devil is trying to do is trying to attack the core issues, because then he can get in all the other areas. Like many of the realities that we experience in this city is the disintegration of the family. That is the most, it is the most fundamental reality that causes the disintegration of society, the disintegration of the family, the breakup of the family. And so the devil's no fool, he's smart. So he's gonna attack the places. He wants to get the best bang for his buck. You know, he doesn't have unlimited resources. And so he knows where to focus. Problem is, we don't know where to focus. And so he's gonna attack life. He's gonna attack the basic institution of society, marriage and family, to try to redefine it. He'll do anything he can. First, he introduced an area which is a hot topic for us because it's so misunderstood, and of course, therefore, not the church's teaching is kind of falls away. It's not practiced. It's the whole reality of contraception but it's the reality of the reality of he wants to destroy family. He wants to destroy marriages. He's doing a pretty good job, isn't he? Seriously, let's be honest. He's doing a really good job destroying marriages and families. He's a pro. Because we're so distracted. We're not, like, reinvesting. We have to reinvest in that reality. And so the legal system either supports or undermines that reality. I've had parents, some of you, many parents actually, sadly in one sense and hopefully in another, who have come to me crying out and saying, I don't know what to do. My children are being indoctrinated by a thinking that says marriage can be between man and woman, or man and man, or woman and woman. It's really whatever's gonna make you happy. Like, they're being indoctrinated, and I'm like, I can't reach them. They're just being, their minds are being filled with this. And they're really, like, in anguish over this, in anguish of heart, in anguish. I don't know what to do. They're being stolen right from my hands. In the name of compassion, which of course we have to have, but it's a misuse of that word in the sense that it's to be anything you want it to be. And so promoting the concept that the theory, the insanity, that I can be a boy today and tomorrow I could be a girl. There is a politician who said publicly, we should allow children, preteens even, to determine their sex. So if they're going through a rough time, you should affirm their sexual preference. What do you create in children when you do that? Confusion! Tell me, do you do that about the other things? Let's see. I just like candy. I'm not eating dinner. I'm just gonna eat candy. So that's all, I prefer candy. Wouldn't they prefer candy than dinner lots of times? I certainly did a lot of times. So you make decisions on what you know is priority. So my point is, no government should be determining what is being fed to your children, but that is the direction of this country. And by the way, not just this country, but the world. The whole world. Because whatever happens here is going out there. I had a conversation at dinner with some of the guys, and we were talking about how Africa is, they were saying, Africa's not dealing with this. This will never happen in Africa. I'm like, wake up. Wake up. It's already happening. Who are you kidding? It's already happening. Don't be naive. Because what's happening in America is going to happen everywhere. So, there are not only consequences in America, but the whole world. The whole world. And so therefore, in conscience, we have a double responsibility to wake up, to be alert, to have clarity about those non-negotiables. I will never negotiate. Never negotiate. Never take them out of the equation. Never. They cannot be bartered. I'm going to get two of these medium-sized ones for this big bowl to take the big one out. I'm going to get two. That's a pretty good deal, right? No, it's not. It's not a good deal. It's a very bad deal for the generations yet to come. That's why we're still squabbling over the pro-life issues, because that's what we did. That's exactly what we did. Seriously. And that's what happened when slavery was permitted in America. The church was saying, well, you know, only one bishop stood up, and man, he got a lot of flack in the early days of it. You know, there are priorities of each time. Because if you fight it well now, you don't have to fight it later. Well, you always have to fight it in some degree, but not in the same degree. It's not in the same degree. There are seasons when this is the battle of the season of the century. And the third one is religious freedom. I don't know if you know this, but there are ministers in Canada who were threatened with arrest, and I don't know if they were arrested actually, but they were told you cannot preach on that topic. It was in the area of sexuality and marriage being only between one man and one woman. And you know, do you know that it's illegal, for example, to try to counsel a child when they are thinking in terms of a sexual sex other than the one they're given at birth, that it's illegal in places to try to counsel them to overcome that and accept and embrace the beauty of their identity as what they were born with, man or woman, as a man or woman, boy or a girl. And so literally counselors are told, you can't do that. You will lose your license. You will lose your license. You cannot do that. That's what's going on. It's real. It's happening, brothers and sisters. That's religious freedom being directly attacked. Even just the closing of churches, boom. You know, yes, of course we have to take precautions. And yes, it's sometimes you have to take radical means to deal with very serious situations. But there are, you know, like the imposition in some way let's just say that it's a serious reality. We have to be very, very careful. Because when you give something away, good luck trying to get it back. When you give a right away, good luck trying to get it back. Good luck. Now, I want to mention another thing, and I'm going to close up. You pray for me that I finish it quickly, because you know I have a hard time doing that. The first reading, King Cyrus. Who is this King Cyrus? Was he a Jew? What was he? He was a pagan. He was a Persian, yeah, a pagan, basically. You know, in particular, he was a pagan. He, whatever degree, worshipped many gods, whatever degree he did. And yet, it says here that he was anointed. Anointed in the same way that God anoints you in baptism. Probably not quite that. Certainly not that. But anointed for a purpose. That's the sense of this. Anointed for a purpose. Now, the Israelites had been taken over by the Babylonians. And they were exiled once. Then they came back, rebuilt the temple. And then they were exiled again. And this is that second exile that this is going on in. And King Cyrus, who is not a Jew and has political motivation in doing what he's doing, more than likely, but God is working through. God is working through, and he uses King Cyrus to say, because he wants to reestablish the different people's independent practice of their religion. Why does he want to do that? Because he believes in all those religions? Probably not. Probably not. I don't know what he believes. We don't even know. We don't know what he believes. We just know that he gave an edict that enabled the Jewish people to rebuild the temple. And he gave a direction that they are given permission to return back to Jerusalem to do that. And he even provided resources, financial resources, and material resources for that purpose. Why? Because God wanted the temple rebuilt. That's why. God wanted the temple rebuilt. And so he chose this pagan king. It's crazy. You know, he chose a pagan king to do that. Why? Because he's God. You know? And so, brothers and sisters, as you look at the reality of how you go to the polls, and make sure you vote. If you have the ability to vote, vote. Yes, personal character is an important reality. It is a very important reality. But if I found out today that Abraham Lincoln was a philanderer, is that the word I want to say? Has many women? What's the word? You know the word, whatever. He was womanizer is another word for it. Thank you. If I found out today he was a womanizer and that he was an alcoholic, and then he had a very foul mouth. And he was a dishonest businessman. But he freed the slave. He ended slavery in America. It wouldn't change the reality of what he accomplished. It wouldn't change that reality. The reality was more important than the stupidity of who he was. Right? I mean, isn't that's like, he had a mission. He was anointed for that mission. He was anointed for that mission. Whatever party he was part of, he was anointed for that mission. And God gave him the courage for that, the ability for that. So, please, yes, there are many issues going on, but we need to make sure that we don't lose those fundamentals, because if we lose those, the other ones, we won't have a leg to stand on. We'll be going like this in life, just trying to stay afloat, because it will not work. We've tried it before. It doesn't work. It undermines all the other priorities that are real. They are real. But you can't fight every battle at every moment. You have to choose which ones are worth dying for in this time. Looking at the consequences that are at stake. So please, beg the Lord to guide you in this discerning process. Beg Him to guide you. Because you know what? It's real hard for someone like me to be able to speak a word because we're always trying to find that balance. But think about it. When the Nazis were taking over Germany, like, one of the problems was the church was silent. There were only a couple martyrs. When Henry VIII declared himself head of the church, how many bishops were martyred? One. Do you know what happened to the rest of them? They joined the party. One bishop and one layman, a great man, one of my favorites, Thomas More. And John Fisher was the bishop. So, brothers and sisters, let's pray for that clarity. There's a battle going on. And God help us. Because it ain't easy to figure things out in these crazy times. But figure them out, or at least prioritize them, some of them. We must, because the stakes are too high. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let us stand to proclaim what we believe. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Brothers and sisters, it is a privilege to intercede, and it is a duty to intercede as we pray, asking the Lord's blessing upon all those who are in need of our prayers, depending on our prayers in Christ Jesus.
That this World Mission Day may renew with all Christian communities the joy of the gospel and awareness of the responsibility to announce it, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all will defend true justice for everyone, regardless of their nationality, language, religion, socioeconomic status, or stage of life, and may we discern rightly the common good of our society according to God's wisdom and order. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have abandoned the practice of the faith, that the grace of Christ will soften their hearts and move them to return to the Lord and to the sacraments. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For children with special needs and their parents and families, that they will be giving all the love and support they need. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all civil authorities who govern, judge, and legislate in the United States of America and around the world, that they might do so with the humility, wisdom, and courage that comes from the Most High, the King and the Lord of all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
During this Respect Life Month, may we be inspired to become more fervent in our prayers and actions for the unborn and their mothers, the elderly and the disabled. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray in this month of the Rosary that through daily family rosaries, as well as our daily online Precious Blood Rosary of Reparation, many graces will be poured out upon all the aspects of our society. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the sick, especially Femi Cayo, Julio Waldemar Izquierdo, Susan DePaul, and all our homebound, and all those who have been infected by the coronavirus, may our Lord touch them with his healing and peace, and inspire with his wisdom and perseverance all who work developing therapies and a vaccine. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the repose of the souls of all those who have died, especially Anna Osazi, Peter Julian Barkley, Archbishop Emeritus John Myers, Gordon Brown, and all our loved ones who have gone on before us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the intentions we hold in our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you, so in need of your grace, and yet you empower us that our prayers impact heavenly realities. We ask that you might hear these prayers and inspire us ever more deeply to pray with confidence in your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Ask the Lord for his blessing upon your offering. We pray that the Lord might give fruitfulness to the offering you make, both in your lives and in the mission of this parish, that we might be good stewards of that offering through Christ our Lord.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
So here I am.
The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, Joseph, our Bishop, the other of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family gathered here, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Yeah. Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
That is also another sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God, Lamb of God,
There is no one else like you, for you are great.
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for your mercy.
For your mercy which endures forever. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for just a moment. Is anyone here for the first time? We would like to welcome you. Anyone here for the first time? Okay, great.
We have a new parishioner. Brother, tell us your name. And your rank, no. and tell us your name.
Brother Lazarus.
And Brother Lazarus, where are you right now? I mean, other than...
I live right down the street.
All right.
The Most Blessed Sacrament.
Well, I'm glad that you came out. Do you get the joke? Brother Lazarus, come out. He got it because he hears it all the time. Praise God. Welcome, Brother Lazarus. Welcome, Brother Andre. I think that's Brother Andre behind that mask. It is. Good. All right. Very good. Welcome. God bless you. Welcome. Tell the other brethren they are welcome. They are most, most welcome. We are delighted to have you here. You know, you bring a flavor by your presence. It's important to realize, by the way, brothers and sisters, that we all do that. Yeah, just get him to sign up. Make sure he gives his tithing envelopes too. No, we all are a leaven. We all are an incense, a fragrance in the world. And we want to be that fragrance, you know, with love. But sometimes that fragrance is welcomed, sometimes it's rejected. But it's always necessary. If we don't, the world would lack the salt to keep it from going into corruption, and the leaven would just be flat, and the light to scatter the darkness. So praise God. Couple of announcements and also going to ask those from Real Love Ministries, I think Adora probably, but whoever else might be, to come forward, as well as Jude or anyone else representing the harvest. First, we're praying the Precious Blood Rosary of Reparation every night at 6:30 p.m., 7 p.m. on Wednesdays via conference call. I encourage you to come to that. Particularly as a commitment for this month of the Rosary, and just to be praying. It's called the Precious Blood Rosary of Reparation because we recognize there's a need to do reparation for the sins of the world, and our own sins, of course. But and that's a consolation to the heart of Jesus. Let me tell you another consolation to my heart. Now, it's not Jesus' heart, maybe it is to his too, but it is to mine. I want to tell you two things. One of the things I'm edified here by at St. Antoninus is by the fact that so many people, now this is going to sound strange, but so many people ask for a blessing at the time of communion because they recognize, I need to, something needs to, whatever. And to me, that's so edifying because it says, I love you, Jesus. I'm not
immediately able to receive you, but I long for you. And so I just say to you, thank you for that edification, for that example. But I also say to you, put me to work. Put Father Marcelinus to work. Put Father Lewis to work. To whatever way we can. Marcelinus, I know Father Lewis can't, has to keep the social distancing. But Father Marcelinus, Father Marcelinus will be available right after Mass to hear confessions right here. Put him to work. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Real Love Ministries. I adore, or someone representing Real Love Ministries here. Real Love Ministries conference is the end of this month and the beginning of next. So I guess I will say something, but maybe next week they'll make an announcement. It is 15th Annual Real Love Ministries Conference, Save Your Family, Building Block of the Church, October 30th, 6 to 10, Friday, 6 to 10 p.m., October 31st, Saturday, 12 noon to 8 p.m., and November 1st, Sunday, 12 noon, a Holy Mass. Oh, that's not 12 noon. What time do we have Mass on Sundays? 10 a.m. The Mass is at 10 a.m. Speakers will be Father Boniface, Father Bill, Father Halbing, and Brother Wakwe Chukwu. And this will be in-person gathering in the main church. It will also be live streamed on YouTube and on Zoom. Encourage you to come to that opportunity of grace. Yes, Harvest is next. You're next at bat. You got a mic?
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Let me step up here so that you all can see me. Just giving a quick announcement about the harvest. You all have the flyers, I'm sure. What we are going to be doing, we have an online giving that is going to be set up as well as Zelle. So we have a program. At the moment, we are sending the programmer all the pictures and stuff that we need. And as soon as we have more information, we would let you know. We do have another program for the in-person, and hopefully by next week we would have everything sorted out and we'd give you more information. In the meantime, you can look out for some form of communication through the regular means with a text as to how you can access the Zelle given and start, you know, reaching out to your friends and family members to assist us in this drive. Thank you so much. If you all have any questions, you can see me in the sacristy. Jude isn't here this week, but as soon as he and Adora and the other team members come back, you would get more information. I'm just standing in the breach right now. Thank you very much.
Praise God. Thank you, Rose. Praise God. So, brothers and sisters, that is November 22nd, around the corner. And Mass here, 10 a.m., and then an online bazaar that will take place at 2 p.m., and that will be through Zoom. So I encourage you to tap into that. Hopefully everyone had received three flyers. Why? Why would I want to give you three flyers? Did everyone receive three flyers?
Yeah.
Who didn't receive three? Did you receive three? Yay. Why did I give you three? So you can give them away. That's right. Please do that. Please. Be fruitful and multiply and give them away. We are resuming our religious education classes soon. Father Peter is coming this week and we'll more actively pursue that. So stay tuned. Soon with Zoom. And one final word. for those who are online, but for everyone, please subscribe to St. Antoninus YouTube. It's very important for us because that will enable us on November 22nd to fundraise through YouTube. If we don't have a number of enough subscribers, we are not permitted to fundraise. And so I ask everyone, please, just go to St. Antoninus YouTube and press that subscribe button. Not only fundraising, by the way, it makes the gospel preaching more out there, because once more people subscribe, it's I don't know how it works, but you know how it works. It gets out there more often. So I encourage you to subscribe there. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And I will try to hear confessions a little bit too after Mass, but Father Marcellinus will be right over here. He'll be on one side, you're on the other, on that cloth screen there. Please stand for the final blessing. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God keep you. May Almighty God always keep every adversity far from you, and in his kindness pour out upon you the gifts of his blessing.
Amen.
Oh, wait a second. The gifts of his blessing.
Amen.
May God keep your hearts attentive to his words, that they may be filled with everlasting gladness.
Amen.
And so may you always understand what is good and right, and do it with courage and faith, and be found ever hastening along the path of God's commands, made co-heirs with the citizens of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. God bless you.
Cease to work.